You're listening to Combat Radio with Ethan Dettenmeyer, right here on LA Talk Radio.
Let's start the show. Joining me, who decided to do his own show yet again, he's on a streak.
It's a rare event.
He's reported for Combat Radio a couple of weekends in a row now.
They're in shock here.
Mark Ryan, who was Quartermaster Gates, Black Sails, Bumblebee, and Transformers 1, 2, 3, and I'm sure if the money's right, 5.
I'll do anything for money, you know me. I'm not.
So will I. They got anything else in that movie available? Is there anything I can do? They got a crazy radio, Autobot. They can. You know.
Hello, Combat Radio World. Yeah. Here we go again. Listen, I just want to say that I have volunteered to get in the tub for TJ's book.
He's not taking it, huh? He's not.
And it's funny because when I was out in Cape Town, we were stood there. I think it was Marta Fernandez was stood there. We were chatting away, and I said, "When am I going to get my kit off and get into one of these scenes you've got going on?" Well, you know, she went, "No, no, we want you to keep your clothes on." I said, "No, I'll volunteer to do it. If you need me to get my shirt off and get in there, I'll be in there like a rat up a drain pipe." And she went, "That's what we're worried about.
That's what everyone wants to hear. I'll be there like a rat in a drain pipe.
You keep your clothes on." She said, "We want the show to be a success. So I'm afraid you've got to keep fully dressed." So that was the response to that. But for TJ, I volunteered. And the funny thing is, it's all been very quiet.
I think we'd all volunteer for TJ and his cause. You know what I mean? Not just because he's a good director, but because he's a good person. Also joining us, our good buddy back with a vengeance, Brandon Hillock of Veronica Mars. How are you?
Hi, how's everyone going?
Good. He was also Jack Sparrow a couple years now at our Christmas breakfast for homeless kids every year, and he is basically Jack Sparrow, even better than Johnny Depp.
Yeah, Johnny's getting tired, you know.
Yeah. Johnny who? What'd he ever do? And then joining us for this bit of epicness is a guy that, quite frankly, he shames us with his awesomeness. You know this guy. He's had a piece of just about everything from, Galactica to Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. to The Walking Dead to Black Sails. Composer, artist, you know, resident genius and musical guru, Bear McCreary. How are you?
Doing well. Hey, guys.
Hey, my first question to you, Bear, looking at this resume of yours, is what the fuck are you doing here?
Why are you here?
I'm gonna take a couple hours off and chat with you guys. You
know, I picture your office to be like, you know, riddled with all these awesome, unique, eclectic instruments, and then somewhere on a desk in a glass case is a black phone. And when it rings, that's yet another high-profile executive or producer saying, "We need you
to save this show. That's totally my space. That's
but, and yeah, awards. You've had a couple of awards, haven't you, as well?
Come on, tell us about... make some space on the shelf this year. It's true.
Yeah. Let's clear off all these awards. Yeah. What's it like when you sit back and be like, you know, the phone rings and you pick it up and you're like, "No, Steven, look, John Williams is doing fine for you, buddy. Look, let him finish out his career doing Schindler's List 2. Hang in there."
You know, Schindler's List 2, The Revenge.
The Red Coat. Yeah. The red.
You know, it's funny. I keep saying, "Okay, this is it. I'm not doing anything else. This is I'm just going to focus on these things." And I get these calls. I mean, I'm very lucky to get these calls. Like when John Steinberg called me about Black Sails, and when David Goyer called me about Da Vinci's Demons, when Joss Whedon calls. You say yes to these phone calls. Yeah, yeah. You know what I mean? So
you don't sit back and be like, "David, Da Vinci's what?"
Yeah, come on, like, look, I don't know. Let me see.
You know, it's between you and Michael Mann. Doing,
yeah, no, I remember my agent calling me. I was in the car driving in Santa Monica, and he called, and I picked up, and he goes, "What are you doing today?" Which, of course, is always the best thing your agent could possibly say.
Yeah.
And I was like, "Why?" And he goes, "Well, Joss wants you to come in and watch the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. pilot." And immediately my car is already 90 degrees turned around. Yeah. You know what I mean? And I'm like, "I'll be right there." Yeah. So it's cool, man. But it's, you know, it's just a juggling act. But when, you know, I'm very lucky that these are the kind of calls I'm getting.
Now, how does it all start with a guy like you? I mean, literally, you're sitting back. You know, you're basically a musician, talented guy. Rocking out, or what are you doing? Like, you're just hanging out, and then how does one get their start in this section of the business?
You know, this is what I would be doing whether I was being paid or not, whether anyone's hearing my music or not. I'm not working more than I was when I was a student or even when I was a kid. It's just that now I'm getting paid for it, and people are listening. Because this has just always been my obsession ever since I was in grade school. I was obsessed with film music, and in high school I started writing as much as I could, and it was just all I ever did, you know. So in that way, I got some very lucky breaks for sure, but it was also in a way sort of inevitable because it's all I ever wanted.
So you were a creative engine.
I was an obsessed nerd is how I would put it. You know, I collected soundtrack CDs.
So you're speaking Brandon's language.
You and me, we're going to hang out.
Yeah, exactly.
Talk about collection.
Yeah, exactly.
Danny Elfman, all the
totally.
Classics,
I just became a professional nerd, you know, so that was sort of how that started.
But what was the first break? Like, when was the first time your phone rang and you're like, what? Are you serious?
The first job I ever got was Battlestar Galactica.
You got to be kidding.
I was 24. I was 18 months out of college, and I started scoring that show. So,
And how did you get it? How'd you get in the running for it? Give us the whole breakdown.
Well, there's a number of things that happened. Most importantly, I was the assistant. I was working as the assistant to Richard Gibbs, the composer who scored the miniseries. Mm-hmm. And among the various things I was doing, I started writing other cues, helping him figure out the percussion layering, because there was a ton of music that had to be written super fast. And then when it went to series, Richard's got a bunch of feature films on his plate, and they give me a shot at scoring a couple episodes while they look for somebody real, because no one's ever going to, like, you know, let a 24-year-old kid do a TV show. Right. But
did anyone tell you that? Did anyone say, hey, this is just a temp gig?
I knew it. I mean, yeah. I knew what the stakes were, and I knew. But you know, I also knew that I was getting a chance to do something real, and my name was going to be on it. And because I'd been doing student films and little indie films, I already had a team built up, my orchestrators, my engineers, my live players, and I just called everybody and said, hey, we're doing the thing that we always do, only I have money for you now.
There you go.
You know what
wow.
I mean?
Wow. Yeah, so that's, yeah, there
it
you
was,
go.
Exactly. It was, so it was great, and we just hit the ground running, and we did the first two episodes. And at the end of that, the producers, at the end of the mix, kind of went up to me and went, hey, that was nice. Why don't you come in tomorrow? Let's take a look at episode 4 and 5. And I just went, okay. And at the end of episode 4 and 5, they said, why don't you come in? Let's look at episode 6. It was a little like, you remember The Princess Bride, where he goes, nice job, Wesley. Yeah, I'll probably kill you in the morning.
Right, yeah.
Battlestar, the first 3 seasons were like that. You know,
you're kidding me.
At any point, if I had been fired, they would have been like, you know what, we're going to get John Williams to do this. Who are you? Yeah. I just would have been like, eh, easy come, easy go.
Right.
But that didn't happen. And you know, I was able to build a relationship with them, and that was essentially my first paying job, and now, it changed everything for me.
How was it working with those producers? Like, where you sit back and they said, "Let's look at episode 4 and 5," and you're looking at it in like the screening room, I guess, or
sure.
And are you just saying, "Well, this is what I think," or are you saying,
"Yeah, well, this is the way
keyboard in front of me"?
No, this is the way the process works for everything. Even today, I'll sit down with the producers and talk narratively and emotion. I don't like to get into details of music with them unless they have a very particular mm-hmm. idea, because it's mostly a chance for them to explain to me, what do you want the audience to feel? Which sometimes this isn't self-evident. There are times when sometimes you didn't get what you want out of whatever aspect of production, or the narrative is so layered and nuanced.
Right.
A thing like Black Sails is a perfect example of this.
Yeah.
What do you want the audience to feel? You know? And as we're watching these episodes, there's a number of ways you can do it. Who's the protagonist? Who's the hero? These are things that
we're still asking ourselves.
Exactly. but you know, there are ways that the score can make or break that. And certainly there would have been a way to score that and highlight a more definitive answer, who the bad guy is. And in the case of Black Sails, it was a matter of being open.
Black Sails is interesting, and it must have been interesting to score, because as TJ said, there's no really good or bad. Everybody's grey.
Yeah.
They're on shades of grey. Some are just dark, and some a bit lighter. Like, you know, Billy and Gates were probably the lighter characters,
mm-hmm.
but everybody's got some very, very, you know, dark. Eleanor's got some dark.
And I think that's the fun of the show, is in trying to piece that together as you watch it. I think a lot of stories are, here's your archetypical hero, your Luke Skywalker, and we're going to follow him or her. And with Black Sails, the fun of it is trying to figure out who that person is. My dad has, you know, he likes things that are not super nuanced in this department, and he got so hooked on Black Sails, and he called me after the last episode, and he goes, "Why do I like Flint? Why? I want to keep watching the show, but why do I like him?" And I didn't really have an answer, you know, because I kind of feel the same way, you know.
So you talk in emotional tones, then, basically. It's all basically an emotional discussion.
Yeah, it's answering that question, what do you want the audience to feel, is the most important part of my job. Because ultimately, I'm that last line of defense, me and the sound design. You've written it, you've directed it, you've cast it. everything is in place, and whatever's missing, whatever layer doesn't get you to that emotional place, it's up to the sound and especially the music to do that. So being able to talk with a producer or a filmmaker on that level kind of answers a lot of questions for me.
So musically, what fits the Combat Radio film coming up? Sitting here with this crazy man, Mark Ryan, what are you thinking? Let's look at episode one or two.
Exactly. Well, you just want to say, like,
have you been drinking the Everclear again? Are you
always. I start every morning with the Everclear.
Well, there's something to that. Maybe we can write a theme for that.
Yes, right.
You know?
So you look at something and you just kind of get a sense of it. I mean, do you need to know the answers right away, or do you need to kind of sit back as an artist and absorb things?
In many ways, I want to enhance the journey that the audience is going to have. Mm. So a lot of the times, I don't read the scripts far out in advance. Black Sails is a great example. Are we cool to talk about spoilers on this show?
Show's gone out. I mean, they just announced.
Tell you what,
they sold it now to the UK. I don't know if you know that, but they've just done a deal with Amazon Prime. They announced it.
I'll keep it vague. But let's say a thing happens that when I was doing the first few episodes. I mean, I actually didn't know that was coming. And what it allowed is it kind of allowed for me to tell the stories and allow you to get hooked to these characters. And I was glad that I didn't know, because that meant when I watched that episode for the first time, that shock of the thing that happened was so shocking to me personally. That then I could say, oh my God, like this feeling that I have just watching the rough cut, I want to enhance it for the audience. Yeah. How can I make it even worse? How can I make it more of a shock? How can we, you know, make these feelings that I'm getting just by watching the rough assembly amplify them with music?
And now, who do you report to on a show like that? Do you report to the director or the producers? I mean, if you're going to bring that level of artistic integrity to it, do you have to like sell it, or do you say this is what I'm thinking?
It's a very collaborative process, and depending on what you're working on, there's different people you report to. In a film, it's usually the director.
Right.
In game, it's often the audio director or like a cinematics director. In television, it's the showrunner, which is a term that's been around for a long time, but I think has come to new meaning in the past 10 years as we've started really understanding guys like David Chase on The Sopranos and people that you see a name on every episode of TV show and you recognize the vision. They're the guiding ship.
So whose idea was it to bring you in for Walking Dead? Who made that call?
You know, for Walking Dead, I was close with Frank Darabont because he was a fan of Battlestar Galactica.
Is that why, really?
Totally. He and I had gotten together. He loved that show. Mm-hmm. There was a time when he was even going to direct an episode and the schedule didn't work out. So he and I had actually been looking for a thing to work on together for a couple years. And then when he got The Walking Dead, he just called me up and there was no demo. There was no audition.
I bet the frustrated composer working as a barista at Starbucks hated to hear that conversation from you in the morning. I may just be doing this thing with Frank Darabont. I don't know. It's my 25th birthday.
Remember how we were talking about phone calls that you don't say no to?
Right.
You know what I mean?
No, you never say no in this business. I mean, I say yes to every meeting. It's funny because after I left Warner Brothers, I set up at what was the Warner Hollywood lot. It's now called The Lot, right next to Darabont. Literally right two doors down from him. And I could not believe how accessible and friendly he was to everybody.
Yeah.
He interact like he would ask the security guards, you know, what are you reading? What's new? What are you doing? And I just you got right away with the guy how he is, who he is, how he is, so to speak.
Absolutely. He's that kind of guy. And it was sort of the perfect marriage of material and the right people creating it. And I was hired on that show before they'd cast it.
Really?
So it was they hadn't shot anything. That's pretty unusual.
Have they brought you down to play a zombie or anything?
Not yet.
Have you asked to do that?
Not yet. I'm hoping
a little bit of stunt cast. Lucas would have done it.
That's true.
He would have made you an Ewok or something. You're too tall for that. He would have made you a stormtrooper or something.
I would have been the guy with the golf balls on his head doing the mocap.
Exactly. So did Darabont sits you down and says, I'm thinking something very original here, Bear. I'm thinking zombies.
Yeah. Let's do something no one's ever done.
Zombie series?
You know. But that is kind of what it was. And you know, it's often a challenge because everybody wants something new, but no one can tell you what it is. You know, everyone, we went through the same thing on Black Sails. I want something that sounds like no other pirate thing ever. And then that's they kind of put that on your plate, like, there, go make cinema history.
You did it.
I don't
though.
Know how to
you
do
did
it. You know?
No, but you did it. You delivered it, man.
Well, it's, you know, that's the fun for me is trying to find those the sounds and the style that are unique. And a lot of that comes from my first gig, Battlestar Galactica. It was a very similar thing where it's hard now looking back on a sci-fi show and realizing how unusual it was that the producers didn't want to hear a big orchestra. Mm-hmm. It seems almost
damn
natural now, but yeah, it really was
too old school.
It was a pretty big deal.
Well, when we were down in San Diego, Con, and you did that gig, that live gig.
Yeah,
we were sitting there watching this, and I went, "That's a hurdy-gurdy. Yeah. This is going to be interesting. What the is that going to sound
like?" Dad, you had heard any of the music at that point? Because I was actually a couple booths up from you.
The first time we heard it was when Bear played it live down at San Diego Comic Con.
Yeah. I'm brought down to do a gig for Mattel, and he's a couple of... He's got the black sales booth, right? And yeah. So I come across him in between, like, I think before I had to make
it was
our
madness.
We had to do an appearance at San Diego State that night, but there was like Mattel, Nickelodeon, Spike TV in a row for us broadcast wise. And I go, and I said, well, you know, let's Hasbro's over there. Let's go. Why don't we go crash Hasbro? Because you're Bumblebee, or we'll. We had just seen how awesome the black sales production value at their booth made the ticket.
Oh, it was crazy!
You know, for those who had to buy a ticket, worth seeing, right? But you know, it's funny because the Mattel executives go, "You will not be doing Hasbro today. You won't be doing." So I was like, "We should do some black sales stuff." But I mean, had you heard the music by the time you and I were talking down there at the convention?
No,
you had no idea what you were in for.
It was hot off the presses. I hadn't heard the final mix yet.
Really?
I had just finished the pilot, like, 4 days earlier in order to get it ready for Comic-Con. So actually what was interesting, as Mark was saying, I did a concert of the Black Sails score at the premiere at Comic-Con. So I got all these musicians together. One of the pieces we played was what I thought would be the main title. The producers hadn't even heard it yet. I had just written that because the main title wasn't in that premiere at Comic-Con. So
man.
I remember getting up there starting to play it, and I'm making eye contact with the guy who will decide whether this is the theme or not, and I'm like, I said to the crowd, this is the theme for Black Sails, I think. You know,
it's like an audition piece. That's
totally.
That's awesome.
But in a way, like, I remember the crowd really got into it, and they were clapping, and as I started playing the hurdy-gurdy, I'm playing this tune, and while I was there at Comic-Con, because the crowd giving me this energy, I just started singing the theme along with me playing, and that's how I got the idea to have the guys in the main title singing it. It wouldn't have been in the show if we hadn't done that concert and that
stop scaring us with your greatness for me. just hold up on the epicness. You know what I'm thinking? How much is it going to cost us to get you to do this Black Sails theme from the decks of a pirate ship down at Comic-Con this year?
Let me get my wallet.
$10
Let's hit our checkbook. We're going to have to pull our checkbook together because we're down there. You should at least crash the party.
Oh, man, it sounds like fun.
VIP treatment.
Because we're going to make Mark walk the plank.
I've got lots of questions about the tone and how you layer this stuff, because I'm a film music buff. We talked about this when I was down in San Diego.
Yeah.
So I'm a big follower of John Barry. I love all that kind of stuff. I'm fascinated by how music can make or break a project, mm-hmm. a film particularly. If somebody like Michel Legrand did a soundtrack for Never Say Never Again and it was dreadful. Great writer, love his music.
Yeah.
Great, you know, scored some great stuff.
That's also not a very good movie.
You know, well, it's not a good film, but if you
Yeah, but there's a lot of not very good movies with great scores.
Yeah, you know what, I'll tell you.
Which saves the film.
One of my favorites is The Man with One Red Shoe. But my kid and I don't like the movie, but she and I both love to hear the theme. I think Thomas Newman did that. But I didn't mean to derail you. What's your favorite track on the soundtrack? Like, give me something to play right now so we can illustrate what Mark's talking about.
I think my jam is the Parsons Farewell track. What is it, 18?
I'm going to it. We're going to need to.
And this pertains to your character, Mark, in a big way, which is pretty cool.
You've got to imagine Flint and I looking at each other across the poop decks of our ships as we sail out to hunt the Urca de Lima, both of us having secrets that we're keeping from each other. So it's that last moment as ships sail away.
And what's cool about this piece is that at the beginning, what you're hearing is essentially their world. You're hearing a pirate band in a tavern. It's like four or five guys just jamming on this tune. And after about 2.5 or 3 minutes, you get into it. it switches into the subjective, into the emotional, the internal, and it basically kicks into this full.
Jeez, this is like
heavy
a science
metal.
Class.
I'm telling you, man. No. But you'll feel it. You'll just feel it. You'll feel it change.
It starts with us on the shot itself, which I really looked at yesterday for something, which is a whole other story. It starts with us looking at each other and acknowledging each other across the deck of the ships. It goes into the tavern where we're having a very intense conversation, Dufresne and I, about something, and comes right in. I mean, God, Mark pushed the camera virtually right up my nose, as did TJ did. They loved doing that towards the end. It was all like, let's see if we can get it right into his head.
Authentic pirate boogers.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, and then it comes out again, goes back to the boats. And so the layering and the timing of the music from the outside internally to the process, back out again, sailing off on this epic thing.
Because what you're hearing is the music in the tavern in the flashback, and then it's what we call source music. It's music that's in their world, and then it becomes score on right on the cut.
Bloody brilliant.
Wow. How about we play it?
Okay, I'd say so myself. Absolutely.
Look at that. See, Mark's even giving him handshakes.
No, it's brilliant. It's very good.
Hang on. Here it is. This is the Parson's Farewell.
You're listening to Combat Radio with Ethan Dettenmeyer, right here on LA Talk Radio.